Here's Marcel Ledbetter's best friend live in Cleburne, Texas, Jerry Clower. Jerry.
Shoot this thing. Oh, my, it's good to be in Cleburne, Texas. I don't know of any place I had rather be. I am on your side. And to top it off, Love Agriculture Week. This is culminating it right here tonight. And I can love agriculture. I'm qualified to be one of you. I can. I growed up on a farm. I joined the 4-H Club at age 9. I wanted to grow up to be like the 4-H Club agent in my county because he so impressed me when I was a little boy. And the only way you can grow up to be like a county agent is get a degree in agriculture. That's right. So I worked my way through Mississippi State University, got a degree in agriculture, and the first job I ever had, I assistant county agent in charge of 4-H Club work. So I done paid my dues. That's right. I remember at age 9, I joined the 4-H Club. And I used to pledge the 4-H Club pledge. I pledged my head to clearer thinking, my heart to great loyalty, my hands to larger service, my health to better living, for my club, my community, my country, and my world. And then I didn't have FFA until I got to Mississippi State University. And the FFA motto, I learned that, learn to do, doing to learn, earning to live and living to serve. Now, you know, I want to salute the American farmer. The American farmer does his job. Listen. The American farmer does his job better than anybody else. Let's face it, the automobile dealers have problems due to competition from other countries. The computer people have problems due to competition from other countries. But if them people in them other countries want to find out how to farm, they have to come to America. And all the American farmer has made so many adjustments to help himself. I remember when I was a young'un living at Route 4 Liberty, Mississippi. We didn't have no electricity. And you tell your young'uns when they go to complaining about getting up at homework that you saw old Jerry Clower, and he said he never got up his homework in his life from the first through the 12th grade other than by the light of a fireplace or a coal oil lamp. And that's the gospel truth. I was 19 years of age before I ever had electricity in my house, and I didn't witness it then. I was invading Iwo Jima. I remember I got a letter from home, and I opened that letter up, and I run down the sands of Iwo Jima, waving that thing over my head, screaming, "Oh!" And them folks took to me, especially them Yankee folks, and said, "Rebel, you done got a letter from home. What's the good news?" I said, "Man, the REA has done throwed off a creosote pole in our front yard." You know, city folks, even today, they have difficulty understanding us country folks sometimes. Well, I was walking by Uncle Ronnie's place one day down at Route 4 Liberty, Mississippi, and I saw a hog in his field with a wooden leg. And I said, "Uncle Ronnie, that's a mighty fine hog you got there. But why does he have a wooden leg?" "Oh, son, that hog's like a member of my family. When our house burned, he rushed in and saved my grandmother. And when little Eula was drowning in a creek, he jumped in and saved her, just like a member of the family. I said, but why does he have a wooden leg? Son, when you got a hog that good, you only eat him one ham at a time. Uncle Versa had a small farm raising a few cows, pigs, and goats. And one day a traveling salesman came by and introduced himself, stating that he sold feed and that he had the best hog feed on the market. The salesman asked Uncle Versa if he had any hogs. Yes, Uncle Versa told him. They walked out to the hog pen. Looking down at three poor hogs, the salesman commenced to give his sales pitch. The quality, the high protein count, the homogenized, homogeneous, pelletized hog food, and how rapid the hogs would grow if Uncle Versa just used his brand of hog food. And they're both looking down at them three hogs, and their ribs are showing. Razorback, long snouted. The salesman asked Uncle Versa, how much you think them hogs will weigh? Uncle Versa said, about 250 pounds. Salesman said, how old are they? Uncle Versa said, they're 8 months old. Salesman said, what do you feed them? Uncle Versa said, slop. Salesman said, well, Mr. Ledbetter, if you had been feeding these hogs my feed, these hogs would have weighed 250 pounds in 4 months. Uncle Versa said, well, what's time to a hog? When I was a boy, me and my brother Sonny used to go to what we call Coon on the Log. Now, it's been outlawed. Don't be writing me no letters. I ain't advocating that we bring it back. It should have been outlawed. But we used to go to Coon on the Log. And I remember one time we went out into this pasture. Ooh, and there was an old coon out there on the log looking over on the bank. And here was two fellas holding a hound that weighed at least 100 pounds. You'd have thought he was fixing to engulf the whole county. Took two grown men to hold him and him lunging at the chain. Man, I told my brother Sonny. I said, that coon ain't got a chance. That's the meanest, baddest looking thing I ever seen. Look at them teeth. Man, he wants him bad, don't he? Everybody was getting their money out to bet on the big fine dog, the fine specimen, the fine big mouth dog, what wanted him bad. Directly they called out that dog's number and unhooked him. He parted the water. Got out there and that coon looked down at him. You know what the big fine dog done? Swum around behind and tried to catch a raccoon in the rear end. Didn't want none of him. And when the coon turned around and snapped him, he stuck his rear end up there. Now you can't bounce, guard, shoot, block with your rear end. Everybody laughed, made fun of this big, fine physical specimen. You know, I've seen some human beings like that. Run out there on the field, boy, he said, boy, look at that and yon. Ain't he built good? But the game starts and he turns his rear end to him. And then you look over there and there's one about 5'10", weighs 180. If you could have a heart transplant, boy, you'd have you something. At this same coon on the log, I stood a little female girl dog. Old boy just sitting there had a rope round her neck. She hadn't said nothing, but she was standing there just staring at that coon. Wasn't moving. Sides is going in and out. Coon wasn't even paying her no attention. Little old female girl dog. Director, they took the rope off that dog. She didn't say a word. She just swam out there. And that dog opened his mouth to grab that raccoon, and that raccoon opened his mouth to grab that dog, and they just locked mouth to mouth and went to the bottom. Vroom! If they hadn't dived down and got her by the collar and prized her mouth loose from that raccoon's mouth, she would have drowned herself, because her heart and her attitude was right, and she was going to be loyal to her species and perform with a maximum effort. And I'm on the side of the 50-pound little old hookworm dog what was ready to give it all she had. Clovis Ledbetter one day was walking to the county fair. And old Clovis was going down there to visit the fairgrounds and do a little trading. And Clovis had a pig under one arm, chicken under the other arm, and a basket on top of his head. And just as he approached the city limits of the county seat town where the county fair is going on, he saw Asley D. Lauder. Now, Asley played hard to get, but she is really wanting to have the privilege of throwing a craving on some old boy. But Asley was some ugly. Ooh, Asley had to slip up on the dipper to get a drink of water. If Moses had a seen Asley, there'd have been another commandment. So, Clovis is walking to the county fair and got this pig under one arm and chicken on the other arm and this basket on top of his head, and he walks up to Asley and says, "Where is the fairgrounds?" Asley said, "You go straight ahead a quarter of a mile and turn right at the sign and walk a quarter of a mile and you'll come out at the fairgrounds." And Clovis said, "Well, if it's down there and to the right, seems to me you could just cut across these woods right here. Be a shortcut and save a lot of time." Asley said, "That's right, it is a shortcut. But I'm taking the shortcut, and I don't want you walking with me, because you may try to hug me." "That's what you'll do, is try to hug me." Clovis said, "You crazy?" Said, "How in the world can I hug you if I wanted to? So I got a pig under one arm and a chicken under the oven, and I got a basket on top of my head." Asley said, "You could put that chicken under that basket and I could hold that little old pig." A new preacher come to this community and was out visiting, and I was Udell Ledbetter out there digging a corner post hole with a post hole digger. And the Reverend walked up and looked at old Udell Ledbetter and said, are you a Christian? Udell said, no, sir, I'm a Ledbetter. Preacher said, sir, you don't understand. What I want to find out is, are you lost? Udell said, heck no, I ain't lost. I know right where I am. I've lived right here all my life. Well, sir, you still don't understand. Are you ready for Resurrection Day? Udell said, when's it gonna be? Preacher said, well, I'm not sure. It may be today or it may be tomorrow. Udell said, well, don't tell my wife. She'll want to go both days. Definition of a cow. A cow is a completely automatic milk manufacturing machine. It is encased in untanned leather and mounted on four vertical movable supports, one on each corner. The front end contains the cutting and grinding mechanism, as well as light sensors, an air inlet and exhaust, a bumper, and a fog horn. At the rear is the dispensing apparatus and an automatic fly swatter. The central portion houses a hydrochemical conversion plant. This consists of four fermentation and storage tanks connected in series by an intricate network of flexible plumbing. This section also contains the heating plant, complete with automatic temperature controls, pumping station, and main ventilating system. The waste disposal apparatus is located at the rear of this central section. In brief, the extremely visible features are two lookers, two hookers, four stand uppers, four hanger downers, and a swishy wishy. Marcel Ledbetter has a son named Tater. Tater Ledbetter. Tater loves to ride to the woodyard with his daddy, Marcel, because the man that owns the woodyard, where Marcel unloads the pup wood, owns one of them little mopeds. And Tater rides the moped. Marcel is unloading the pup wood, and Tater was on the moped. Come skimming down the street there. Stopped at a red light. And just as he stopped at the red light, out of a new car showroom across the street drove out a $57,000 Mercedes. Slammed on brakes at the red light. The little boy leaned over and put his nose against the window. And the guy spooled the window down. And Tater said, oh, what a beautiful car. Smell them leather seats. Good gracious, look at that dashboard. It looks like a jet airplane. Man said, thank you, little boy. You so friendly. Tater said, how fast will this car go? Man said, 140 miles an hour. Prettiest car I ever saw in my life. And the man said, thank you, little boy. You are very courteous. The light changed and the fella in the Mercedes thought he'd just scratch off and impress the little boy. left tire tracks in the middle of the street. Got up about 120 miles an hour. And he saw a speck coming in the rearview mirror. And that speck was getting bigger and bigger. And about that time, it was something roared by that Mercedes. And the fella said, "Good gracious alive. That looked like that little boy on that moped." Couldn't have been that little old boy. Ain't no way that little old boy could have caught me. About that time, he saw a speck coming back. He said, "Good gracious alive, it was that little old boy on that moped. I ain't believing this. Woo, he's on that moped." And he looked, and here come the speck in the rearview mirror again. Getting closer and closer. And wham! Something hit the back of that Mercedes. That moped knocked a dent in the cooter shell of that car. Wham! The little old boy fell in amongst them broke parts of that moped. Fella jumped out of that big fine car and run back there, and that laid the little old boy down on the pavement. Fella said, "Son, I'm so sorry this happened to you. Is there anything in the world I can do for you?" And a little boy looked up and said, "Yes, sir. You can unhook my suspenders from your side view mirror." God's so good to me. I had the privilege not too long ago of doing Hee Haw. And that's a fun show. But to show you what a fun show that is, while I'm standing up there and that lady's daubing that makeup on my face, Mr. Roy Acuff, God love him. I love him so much. Such a great American, Mr. Roy Acuff. He come, isn't he? Beautiful fellow. Oh. Mr. Roy Acuff come walking up to me and said, "Jerry, this old boy saw his neighbor and said, 'Hey, what do you feed your dog?'" Fell said, "I feed my dog dog food." Said, "What you feed your dog?" Said, "I feed my dog turnip greens." Fell said, "I couldn't get my dog to eat turnip greens." Fella said, "My dog wouldn't eat them for a month." Talking about a country boy, Marcel Ledbetter. Ooh. I went to see Marcel not too long ago, and they had some bad weather. And Marcel, when the big cloud come up, went and laid down in a pea patch. Laid down in a water fur. Just sprawled out in that patch of peas. Wind come, blowed down a bunch of stuff. Scattered roofs all down through the pasture. A lot of folks was bunged up, but Marcel walked out of that pea patch grinning. They said, "You idiot, what'd you go over and lay down in a patch of peas for?" Marcel said, "Them peas had saved my life so many times before, I just figured they'd protect me from the storm." You know, as I travel around over the country and talk to young people, I would like to suggest to young Americans who are looking for work, if you get work, find out who the boss is. I mean, the first day you own the job, you ask them, "Who's the boss?" Now, you'd be surprised. I do 200 shows a year all over the world. Not too long ago, I was in one of the nicest places on earth to perform. I got there and the sound man come to me and said, Mr. Clow, I'd like to know how you want the sound. I said, fella, you a professional. You just go ahead and fix the sound like you want to, and I'm sure it'll be satisfactory. He said, thank you. Directly a guy walked up and said, Mr. Clow, how you want the lights? I said, I don't know nothing about them. You must be a professional. They wouldn't have you hired here to do these lights. You just make me look as good as you can. I know you ain't got much to work with. He said, well, thank you, sir. And about that time, the master of ceremonies that runs the show said, Mr. Clow, would you mind entering the back door and walking down through the crowd and coming up on the stage? We just lack for people to do that. So a lot of artists who come here refuse to do it. I said, look, fella, I done hired out to y'all. And I done found out who the boss is. And I'm here to serve you. I'll be glad to walk through this audience. He said, good gracious. No wonder it's so hard to book you. Well, now that's a slam against my profession. So let me tell all you young people, and some of you older ones need to learn it. Find out who the boss is. Not too long ago, I was visiting at a great industry, and they invited me to go to the coffee break. And I went in the employees' lounge, and that was about 100 folks in there drinking coffee, and I'm fellowshipping with them and having a good time. About that time, a discussion started about a memorandum that the president of the company had just written to all the employees. And the president of the company had told them, when you leave the restroom, turn the light off. And a fellow sitting way over there said, I have been doing some research, and I do believe that I can prove that cutting the light on and off so many times a day may take more energy than if you let the light burn all the time. What do you think, Mr. Clower? I said, well, sir, who wrote that memorandum to you? Said, it's the boss, the president of the company. I said, he tell you to do some research? Said, no, it's just one sentence here. When you leave the restroom, turn the light off. I said, well, sir, if I was you, I'd go to the restroom and go to practicing me some coordinating exercises, and I'd be practicing up with the zipper and down with the light. I'm fired up about being in Cleburne, Texas. I am. I'm fired up about being in Cleburne, Texas, and I love you. And I would like to suggest to all young people who listen to my voice, you hear me challenge you to have the right attitude, and you hear me challenge you to give an honest day's work for an honest day's pay, but don't ever let your zeal run ahead of your knowledge of the facts. You know, I was witnessing to an old boy, bad fella, telling him about the Lord, and he decided that he wanted to become a Christian and serve the Lord, and he got a good dose of it, but the next day, he wanted to go to teaching in the seminary. I said, now friend, I think your zeal to serve the Lord is running ahead of your knowledge of the Word of God. So you need to study a little bit more. One of the finest examples of getting too excited or letting your zeal run ahead of what you're doing is a true story about Jerry Clower and his family. I have one son and three daughters. My son played Dixie Youth Baseball, and they were good at it. Team he is on won the city championship, won the state championship, and went on to Florence, South Carolina, and played in the World Series. And me and his mom will never be the same after that. It was just super. During the regular season, one night they had a crucial game. Ray Clower was playing for the Kimmy Kids. And I loaded up Ray in my car and loaded up his little sister, Amy. My wife stayed home with my other daughter, who wasn't very old, Sue Baby. So me and Ray and Amy went to the Dixie Youth Baseball Park and saw a beautiful game, and Ray hit a home run. My boy hit a home run and won the game. When the game was over, I rushed home, slammed on brakes under the carport, run into the house, and I called my wife, Homerlene, "Darling, come here quick. Ray hit a home run. Ray hit a home run. Oh, won the game, hit a home run." Homerlene said, "Darling, settle down. You're too excited. It's not good for you to get that excited. You may even have a heart attack." I said, "I'm not too excited." Homerlene said, "Jerry, where is Amy?" I rushed back to the ballpark. And my neighbor, Billy Stampley, was standing under a streetlight with his arm around Amy. He had seen Amy crying. And when I drove up and stopped and jumped out of the car, my neighbor, Billy Stampley, said, "See there, Amy? I told you not to cry. I told you just as soon as your daddy got home, your mama would send him back after you." I never talked much about Clovis Ledbetter. You know, Clovis was the one that was downhearted all the time. He didn't want to be Clovis. He wanted to be a log truck. But he got up in years and fell in love with a girl, and he decided he wanted to talk to her. And he got him a job as a deputy sheriff. And I was born and raised right on the Louisiana, Mississippi line. And you can take your pick as to what side of the county he was in, whether he was in a parish down in Louisiana or whether he was in a county in Mississippi. But he was a deputy sheriff right on the line. And this individual sheriff's department was notorious for gathering up names of the dead. When an election time rolled around, if they didn't have sufficient votes to get elected. So the night before the election, the sheriff and deputy sheriff Clovis Ledbetter was out in the graveyard with the clipboards writing down names. They started on the far side and got right in the middle of the graveyard. And the sheriff told Clovis, said, "Clovis, we got enough names here. This is sufficient. Let's go." Clovis said, "Uh-uh, no, you don't. We ain't gonna be unfair about this thing. I tell you right now, we gonna write down every name in this graveyard, because these people over here on this side's got just as much right to vote as this folks over here on this side." You know, when I was a boy, if you got a whooping at school, you automatically got one when you got to the house. That's just automatic. I mean, it wasn't no... I was talking to a friend of mine who's chief of police in a southern city the other day, and I asked him what's his biggest problem. He said, "Man, biggest problem I have is mamas and daddies won't believe me when I tell them. And we show them, and they'll stand right up in front of the young'un and say, 'It's y'all's fault.'" Well, it reminds me of a story the last day of school when I was a little boy. Man, I hated that workbook. I didn't like that workbook none. And me and all my girlfriends what rode the school bus with me, I recruited them to tie up them old workbooks, them old paper workbooks. And I would throw all of the paper out of the back of the school bus, and we'd just snowstorm the road with old tow-up paper. And man, we took off, and I sat down on that old bench and rolled that tarpaulin up that covered them back windows, and I'm scattering that paper down them dirt roads. Boy, I'm covering it. Just as we pull up to my house 2.5 miles from the school, here comes one of the finest professors I ever had, Mr. Ray J. Turner, in a little old 39 Ford. And he slammed on brakes right up there on that dirt road just as I stepped off that school bus. And I said to myself, school's over, you idiot. You ain't got no control over me. And I saw my mama standing on the front porch. I said, he ain't got nerve enough to even raise his eyebrow at me. My mama come down here and beat him to death. That school man had followed that school bus. Saw that paper coming out of the back of that school bus when I just covered the campus. And when I stepped off that school bus, he grabbed me by the nape of my neck, by my overhaul jumper collar back there, and started to his car. And I looked toward the front porch and said, Mama! And my mama raised up on her tiptoes and cupped her hands where everybody could hear. She said, Mr. Turner, if my boy's done something he shouldn't, you have my permission to tie him up. You know, I go to athletic events and I see some big, fine physical specimen, all built like a government mule. And you just know he's gonna be the best athlete participating in the contest. And when a game starts, you see he ain't nothing but mouth and don't have no chitlins. Oh, give me one of them individuals who has a heart and who has an attitude and wants to accomplish and do the best they can with what they got. You know, sometimes attitude is more important than facts. If little David had listened to the facts, he never would have fought Goliath. Somebody say, well, they got a good team, but they sure are small. I say, man, I saw a yellow jacket that long one time. Little old bitty yellow jacket, about a half an inch long, made a 2,000-pound Bramer bull jump an 8-strand barbed wire fence.